morning and welcome to Wesley Amazon Church, where we're working the vineyard through faith, worship, witness, and service. We're so glad you joined us on today, and we look forward to having another great worship experience with you. And let's do so by preparing our hearts to go into our word, which can be found in the book of Daniel, chapter 3, verse 28. That's the book of Daniel, chapter 3, verse 28. And it reads as follows. Then Nebuchadnezzar said, "Praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angels and rescued his servants. They trusted in him and defied the king's command, and were willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own God." Amen. I want to share this morning from the subject of witnessing for Christ in difficult times. Witnessing for Christ in difficult times. Let us pray. Gracious Father, we bless you now. We give glory, honor to your name. We ask now that in all of your power, your wisdom, that you would come. Fill me afresh, O God. Anoint me afresh, O God, to serve your people. And I ask now, God, that you would open our ears and help us to listen. Open our eyes, for we want to see Jesus. Then I pray that you'd open our hearts that we might receive him. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. Amen. Witnessing for Christ in difficult times. See, sometimes as Christians, we wonder, what do we do when we find ourselves on hard times, or even as we find ourselves now in society that is facing hardships? Do we continue to tell others about God? Do we continue to witness? Do we continue the gospel message of Jesus Christ? Well, I want to share with you today that as Christians, we never quit sharing the message of God. We never quit sharing the gospel message of Jesus Christ. And in fact, in hard times or difficult times is when we need to share it the most. When people are being challenged on every side, when people are going through, we need to share with them that there is an answer and a solution to the problem that they're facing. Yes, many may not believe you, and they may not even want to hear what you have to say, but it's our Christian duty to share the gospel message, to share the good news that there is a God who can deliver them out of their bad situation, that there is a God who, most of all, can save their souls. So as we prepare to look at this text on today, we have to keep in mind that as Christians, we must be willing to declare openly statements of truth about God and allow God to confirm our declaration. We got to allow God to confirm that which we say about him, and to confirm that, yes, it is true. Well, one of the first things that I want us to see out of our text is this. We witness by profession. Yes, we witness by profession. That means that we declare openly or publicly what we believe. Now, let me share right here that sometimes our profession may be true or not true, or it may be sincere or non-sincere. You see, when we think about that profession, declaring something, we make a statement or declaration, the question that follows that, is this declaration a true declaration that you're making? Is it a declaration of faith that you're going to follow? And as we start here with this profession of faith, and we have to go and remember that in Matthew 26 and 35, it gives us the account of Peter, who made a profession of his faith. He made a profession and said that he was going to stick with Jesus no matter what. If the others would forsake him, that he would be right there. But just a few verses before that, you find that Jesus said that you would forsake me before the cock crows three times. And exactly that is what happened when Peter heard the cock crow. He remembered what Jesus said unto him, that you would deny me thrice before the cock crows. Peter may have felt like he was going to stay with Jesus. He may have felt like he would keep his oath and his promise, but Peter found out, like many of us, we sometimes make a profession of faith and we do it out of our emotions. You see, Peter made this profession of faith, and he believed that he would follow through on it, but he found himself falling short of his profession. You see, we often make these public declarations out of emotions, just like Peter did. And in our text, the three Hebrew boys, the young men, they give us an example of what it means to give a true confession or profession, a true profession of our faith, and what it means to follow through on that profession. You see, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego professed to believe and serve God. And yes, in their profession, their public declaration, they openly declared that they would serve the Lord and serve him only. And in case you're not familiar with the text, they had been put in a situation where King Nebuchadnezzar had put out a decree, and he had made this grand golden statue and said that at a certain time, the music would play and everyone would bow down to this statue. Well, the Jews and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and their friend Daniel were not bowing down to the statue as the king had ordered. And some took this as an opportunity to try to get the Jews out of the way. And so they brought them in before the king, and the king asked them one more time, I'm going to give you one more chance to bow down before the golden statue when you hear the music play. Only to have Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answer the king and say, O king, there's no trouble for us to answer you. We will not bow down no matter what you do. We won't give our knees over to any other god except our God. And that upset the king to the point that he began to be angry with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And he had them bound up and told them to be thrown into the fiery furnace, which was supposed to be heated 7 times hotter. Yes, you see, we find out that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had made this open declaration. They had made this open profession of their faith. And see, they publicly declared that God had the ability to deliver them out of their situation. They said, we would trust in our God to save us out of the midst of this situation, O king. But they even went so far as to say that even if he doesn't, O God, we still won't bow down and worship your golden image or your statues. You see, they had made a grand declaration. They made a grand public profession of their faith. But they even went so far as to say, if God doesn't deliver us, we still will serve and we still will not bow the knee to anyone but him. You see, it does not matter what the conditions are around us as Christians. We should be willing to make a sincere and positive profession of our faith in God. You see, witnessing for God doesn't stop when things get a little hard. You see, it's easy to witness for God when everything is going great. It's easy to witness for God when everything seems to be moving in the direction that you would want it to go. It's easy to witness for God when there's no lack in your life. It's easy to witness for God when everyone's health is good. It's easy to witness for God when death hasn't knocked on your door or the door of your loved ones. It's easy to witness for God when everything around you is in good shape. But what happens when we find ourselves in some situations where everything around us isn't that great? What happens when we find ourselves in bad shape? What do we do then? Do we continue to witness for God? You see, can we profess that God is good even in bad times? Can we profess that God is a provider when we find ourselves in lack? Can we profess that God is a healer even in the midst of sickness? Can we confess that God is a good God that's worthy to be praised and a worthy to be glorified even when death invades our world? Can we profess that God is a good God no matter what we're facing and no matter what we're going through? Can we confess and profess that God is a good God no matter what the world seems to be throwing at us? Can we profess that God is good even in the midst of difficult times? Can we give a public declaration that God is still God and that we believe God over everything that presents itself in our life? That's what we must be as Christians. We got to learn to not be private Christians, but to be public Christians. We've got to make our belief public. We got to make our faith public. We got to show our trust in God as a public thing. The second thing that I want us to see out of our text is this. We witness by confession. As we look in our text, we find that around the 17th verse that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego began to make some confessions. Now, a confession is a statement or a declaration of truth. There's something that we state that has truth behind it. You see, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego made their declarations or their confessions, and as verse 17 lets us know that they made, first of all, the confession that there is only one true God. When you look at verse 17, it says, if we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us. Hallelujah. You see, they declared that there is only one God. They declared that there is no other God. And in fact, they're in a situation because they declared that there is only one God. And because they declared that there is only one God and only one God that they would serve, they found themselves in the midst of being thrown into this fiery furnace. You see, we are often confronted ourselves with competing true claims about other gods. Yes, but we got to understand and realize we have the only true and living God. We serve the one and only true God. You see, they understood you don't bow down to something that you conceived in your mind and that you have formed with human hands. That's one thing that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego understood. We don't bow down to things that we create in our head and that we form with our hands. How would you bow down to something that you created? How can you bow down and give something authority over you that you created? You see, they also made this declaration that the one true God is full of grace, truth, and glory. Yeah, they believed that God would save them no matter what. They believed that God would be on their side no matter what they were going through. They made this declaration, this confession that God was full of grace, truth, and glory. And see, they made another confession too. They said that God is the true self-existent God. He is spirit and he is eternal and he is unchanging. Hallelujah. They believed that God was going to serve and be there for them no matter what they were going through. And the one thing that I believe that got into their heads and their hearts during this time was that he is almighty and that he is sovereign. Yes, they may have found themselves in a bad situation, but they still believed that a good God was going to be with them and that a good God was going to work with them even through this bad situation that they were in. You see, this confession of this statement of truth to hold on to the God that they had because God showed them that he was the most powerful God that there was. He showed them he was the most powerful authority that there was. You see, this confession that their God holds all power and authority over all other gods is what they were declaring. You see, the Hebrew name used in the text for God is Eloi, and which is the singular form of Elohim, which is Almighty One. Hallelujah, all-powerful one. Yes, they used the word Elha in this text to let us know that the God that they serve had all power and had all authority. So their confession is not just a confession about serving God. Their confession is about serving the God who has all power and all authority. They were trying to let us know that God has all the power and authority in the world. And that's what we have to do as we share our faith with those that are out in the world. We got to let them know that we serve a powerful God, a God that has more power than anyone, a God that has more power than any situation that you can find yourself in. We serve a God that is able to do above and beyond anything we can imagine or think. We serve a God who was able to move in and out of all of our situations and deal with them in a way that will bring us out for the better. You see, they were doing so, and so their confession was giving them this opportunity to witness before the king Nebuchadnezzar. And see, by refusing to bow down and worship other gods or images, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were establishing the fact that only Yahweh is worthy of receiving reverence and worship. Hallelujah. You see, maybe that they had the first four commandments in mind when they had this thing come out of their mouth. Maybe they had it in their mind. They understood that there should be no other God before me. Maybe they had it in their mind when they understood that there should have no God and make any images of anything in the earth or anything on the ground or in the sea. Make no other images and bow down to worship to them. Then maybe they had it in their mind that they should not take the Lord thy God's name in vain. Maybe they had it in their mind that they should make sure that they remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Maybe they had these four commandments in their mind as they began to go out in front of the king and make their confession and their profession, that they understood that God is above everything and that the God that they serve is the God that they're dedicated to. They're dedicated to God in a way like no other. They're dedicated to God in this way because they have made this grand profession, and now they're making this confession, a statement of truth about the God that they serve. He has the power, the wisdom, and authority to do anything he chooses to do. He has the power, the wisdom and authority to do whatever he wants with his creation. In other words, they understood the sovereignty of God, that God is able to do whatever, whenever, and however he wants to do it. When we understand the sovereignty of God, we realize that we may find ourselves in some bad situation. We realize we may find ourselves in some difficult situation, but we've got a God that can move above our situation. We've got a God that can move even in the midst of a bad thing and make it turn out for our good. We've got a God that is able to do exactly what we need him to do. Hallelujah, hallelujah. When we think about this thing, we go on to our third and final point. Our witness is supported by confirmation. Yes, when we get through that 19th and through the 28th verse, we'll see that there are some confirmation that God brings about to confirm that what's been said is true. You see, God supports the declaration or statements that have been made about him with evidence that these statements are true. And as God makes these declarations, as he proclaims that what's been said about him is true, we find out that there's a reason why Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego wouldn't bow the knee. We find out that there's a reason why they wouldn't honor the king the way he wanted to be honored. We find out there's a reason why they serve God the way that they do. And when we look at the text, we see the first thing that they did confirm before God is this: his ability to save them. Yes, in verse 17, we see that they give us a reason that God is giving them salvation in the first place. You see, God spares the lives of his servants while the soldiers die while taking them to the fiery furnace. Isn't that a good God? He's able to spare the life of his servants. Why? Because their destruction was sure. They were being led to the slaughter. But God stepped in and made a way out of no way. But God stepped in and kept them from dying while the soldiers who were intending to put them in died in their place. Hallelujah. Then the second thing that God confirmed is his authority over the king. You see, they put Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace, tied up and bound up. But if you look at the text, it tells us that their ropes came loose and that they became free in the midst of the fiery furnace, and that they began to walk around. While the king was trying to bound them up, while the king was trying to put them into bondage and slavery, God came and freed them. Don't you understand that God is able to come and free you out of any situation that you've been bound up in? Maybe you've been bound up in an addiction. God can come and deliver you from that addiction. Maybe you've been bound up in financial debt, indebtedness. God can come and deliver you out of that financial indebtedness. Whatever you've been bound up in, whatever has you wrapped up, tied up, and tangled up, God can come and deliver you out of that situation. God can set you free and give you authority over those things that have been binding you. You see, the third thing that God confirms in the text is that he has all power. You see, God is always so shows his power over nature in the midst of this thing. He also shows his power over the natural orders of things in the midst of this. You see, they said the furnace was heated up 7 times hotter than it normally is. But yet Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego aren't killed in the midst of this fiery furnace. And it says that they went in. The text makes it perfectly clear that when they went in, they were fully clothed with hats and robes and pants and all of those things that should have burned up, easily catch fire in the midst of it. But God was able to shelter them. God was able to keep them in the midst of it all. God was able to keep them fully clothed and unfinished by the fire. He was able to keep them fully clothed and unharmed and untouched by the fire. And I'm so glad that it says at the end of the text that when they came out, they didn't even smell like smoke. Hallelujah, isn't that a good God? And when we understand that God is all powerful, that yes, even especially in the situation that they were in, in a furnace that was heated 7 times hotter than it was supposed to be, but God was able to keep them in the midst of it all. And the fourth thing that God confirms is this: he has the ability to care for his people. Oh, I like this part. It said that God came down and got in the midst of the fiery furnace with his people. Hallelujah, hallelujah. When you look at the text, it said the king looked over and said, did we not put 3 in the fiery furnace? Well, now I look over and I see 4 men down there, and they're walking around free and loose. And one of them looks like the son of the gods. Hallelujah. God will come down and get in the midst of your situation with you. We got a God that cares. We got a God that is loving. We got a God that is honorable. We got a God that comes to see about his people. And when you think it's all over, when you think there's no one there for you, you'll find out that God is in the midst of your situation with you. He'll never leave you or never leave you alone, but he's always right there with you. And sometimes you can feel him right there, even in the midst of your situation. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And see, the last thing that I want us to understand is this: his confirmation is about who he is. He gave a confirmation to us about who he is. And yes, how did he do that, Jones? He did it through the king of himself. Hallelujah. King Nebuchadnezzar himself, after seeing everything that he saw down in the fiery furnace, he makes a declaration on his own accord because of what he's seen, what he's witnessed at the hand of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and of our Almighty God. That, yeah, he begins to say, I believe that this God that they serve, Daniel, yes, Shadrach, and even Meshach and Abednego, the God that they serve is to be praised. Yes, King Nebuchadnezzar said it out of his own mouth. Because of what I witnessed, because of what I seen, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's God is to be praised and be glorified. Yes, and if anybody says anything bad about his God, anything bad about their God, they're going to find themselves on the other end of the death chain. Hallelujah. When you think about what that is, he began to praise God. He began to offer praise unto a God who showed up and showed himself mightily on behalf of his servants, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He showed up and showed himself mighty in the service of his kingdom, in the service of his people. You see, when God shows up on our behalf like that, when God shows up and confirms his word like that, when he shows up and confirms the truths about him in the way that he did in our text, we understand that God is a good God and he's a mighty good God. You see, by the close of the chapter, Nebuchadnezzar is giving God the glory and giving God the praise for because he's shown himself mightier and powerful than he could ever be. Hallelujah. And as we close, we want to understand that we serve a great God. We serve a God that is worthy of praise and witness. We serve a God that is able to accept the glory that is due his name. We serve a God that is always worth talking about. And see, we don't stop talking about God because of a bad situation. We keep on talking about the goodness. We don't stop talking about the goodness of the Lord just because I find ourselves in difficult times. We don't stop talking about the goodness of the Lord just because hard times come our way. And in fact, that's the best time to talk about the goodness of the Lord. That's the best time to witness for our God. You see, our witness must go on, whether good times or in bad times. Make your profession known to God in the good times, even when it's hard times. Make your profession known unto God. Declare that no matter where you go and publicly profess your faith, that God is a good God. Declare no matter where you go and make sure that you share it all the time that you're out in public how good a God we have on our side. And while you're at it, give yourself some statements of truth to share with the people that are out there. Make some statements of truth while you're going through this world. When you find yourself out there sharing with the gospel of Jesus Christ, share some confessions and some statements of truth. Tell them that he can save their souls. Tell them that he can deliver them from any situation. Tell them that he has the power over all circumstances and that he's the most powerful God that there is. Tell them that he's a keeper. Tell them that he is present in bad situations, no matter how bad they are. You see, how will they know that it's true, John? You just tell them about your situation. You just tell them about how God delivered you. You just tell them about how he brought you through. You just tell them about why you trust him so much. You just tell them about how he's changed your life. Tell them about how he delivered you from the issues that had you caught up, wrapped up, and tangled up. Tell them about how he made a way out of no way for you, and now you find yourself on easy street. Tell them about how you're going through even bad times yourself, but the God that you serve is on your side. All you're doing is confirming the good God is worthy of praise, glory, and honor. All you're confirming is that God is there for us, that God will lead and guide us even in the midst of tough times. All you're doing is declaring to them, don't quit yet, don't give up yet. There's a God out there that can make it all possible for you. There's a God out there that's fighting on your side. There's a God out there that's willing to save your soul. There's a God out there that's willing to lead you through any bad situation. There's a God out there that is waiting on you to acknowledge who he is. There's a God out there who's willing to work on your behalf. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So if you understand the message today, we have a job to do. Even in tough times, we must go out and witness. Even in tough times, we have to share the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. Even in hard times, we still tell the story of how God saved our souls and how he bought us into a right relationship with his son, Jesus Christ. So just because we're facing difficult times, just because there's challenging times all around us, it's not a time for us to be quiet and be silent, but it's a time for us to go public even more with what God has done for us. As Christians, it's always a time to go public. It's always a time to profess who we believe in. It's always time to confess the truths about him. And it's always a time for God to show up and confirm our confessions of truth about him. So we thank you today for joining us. And we pray that you'll join us again for another opportunity to worship. We ask now that if you have not accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, won't you consider that today? Won't you consider giving your life over to Christ? Yes, we're facing tough times. All of us are in tough times. But now is a good time, if you haven't, to give your life to Christ. Now is a time that you confess your sins before a holy Father and ask him for forgiveness, to come in and cleanse you, to make you righteous and give you a place in his kingdom. Won't you accept Christ Jesus Christ today? Won't you acknowledge your sins before him? There is an answer for your problem, and his name is Jesus. God bless.